We're getting new reaction this week to the Biden administration's 20-year ban on oil and gas leases in and around the Chaco Culture National Historical Park. Interior Secretary Deb Haaland consulted with Native tribes before issuing the decision, enshrining a 10-mile buffer surrounding it. The All Pueblo Council of Governors, which represents 20 Pueblos, celebrated the action, saying it will protect cultural heritage, but the Navajo Nation's top leader, President Boo Nigrin, is disappointed. His government wanted a smaller buffer, saying the 10 miles eliminates economic opportunities for more than 5,000 Navajo allottees. Now, the Interior Department says the withdrawal only applies to public lands and federal mineral estates, not minerals owned by private, state, or tribal entities, meaning Navajo allottees can continue to lease their minerals. New Mexico and Focus correspondent Antonia Gonzales wanted to get more context around this decision. This week, she sits down with the chair of the Chaco Heritage Tribal Association to talk about what the Interior Department's decision means for Native tribes.
Brian, welcome to New Mexico in Focus.
Thank you.
Well, Chaco Canyon in northwestern New Mexico holds both cultural resources and is sacred to many Native nations. Please explain and tell us a little bit about Acoma's ties and other Pueblo communities.
Sure, yes, Chaco Canyon, or Washbashaka in our language, is one of the significant settlements of our Pueblo people. Our ancestors, at the time of emergence, were instructed that there would be some designated stops along the migration before we arrived at our permanent settlements. And the initial settlement was the Mesa Verde region, and that region is quite vast. It isn't the only in the Mesa Verde Park proper, but it extends east and further west of the Mesa Verde region. And then, you know, years later, the ancestors migrated to this place called Washbashaka, and it was at Chaco where there were a number of things that were to occur. It was really a time for our ancestors to really engage in the science of things. And, you know, these monumental structures were built. There was a study of both the lunar and solar cycles that then informed the advancement of ceremony and other cultural and religious observances. So because of those things and other factors, it's a significant ancestral site. We have ties either through clan or perhaps through some societies that cause us to return to Chaco, make that physical return back to the place for prayer and the observance of our respective cultures.
And your work as governor advocating for the buffer, not only here in the state, locally there, and also on a national level. Share a little bit about that.
Sure. Well, you know, my work with this issue began in the late 1990s. When I served as the director of the Pueblo's Historic Preservation Office. And during that time, the Pueblos were already engaged, along with other tribes, in the, advocating for the protection of Chaco. Because there was so much encroachment by the oil and gas industry, there was continued excavation, illegal excavation of outlier sites associated with Chaco. And so there were some significant issues at that time that were, you know, causing this concern. Fast forward to my time as governor in 2019 through 2021, you know, I had the opportunity to represent my Pueblo in the discussions with other Pueblo leaders, the Navajo Nation, and other tribes who have a cultural affinity to Chaco, to further advance this need, really, to protect Chaco. And, you know, there were also some other concerns that became paramount, including the protection of the environment, the land and the resources that were being impacted as a result of fracking and the extraction of resource from the earth.
So then what was your reaction when you heard that Secretary of the Interior Deb Haaland took this action?
Well, I was very grateful. And it's something that has been, you know, a long time coming. And it was really gratifying that the Biden administration recognized and finally heard the voices of the Native people and understood why we continue to insist upon these protections of Chaco. So it's monumental, but we also realize that there is still so much work to be done. I chair what's called the Chaco Heritage Tribal Association, and we are tasked with developing really the first ever ethnographic study of the Greater Chaco region for the purpose of informing the federal government and its agencies about the cultural significance of the place and the spaces that are Chaco. So, you know, I go back to the comment earlier that there's so much work still to be done, but this protection, at least for over the course of the 20 years, provides us the opportunity to educate and inform, and it will, you know, really sets the stage for advancing the discourse around the cultural protections, but also access to the resources, because as I said earlier, we do return to Chaco and outlier sites for cultural observances. And, you know, to ensure that this significant cultural resource is there for our future generations. And as a, you know, World Heritage Site, a national park, that it continues to be accessible to the public.
And Secretary Haaland did travel to New Mexico recently for an event that shifted from the site to here in New Mexico. You were there. What did she say to you, and what did she say to the other guests?
Well, Secretary Haaland had a bit of a day. You know, the intent was to have the event at Chaco Canyon this past Sunday. But because she and other tribal representatives were met with protesters who included that included Navajo Alatis, the event was canceled at Chaco and was rescheduled later in the day here in Albuquerque at the Bureau of Indian Affairs regional office. And it was a great occasion. Despite what happened earlier in the day, we came together to acknowledge this monumental decision of the federal government, and to give thanks, you know, to our ancestors, to everyone who has been involved in this effort. You know, the hard work, the prayers, and the dedication of many to ensure that these protections were realized. I did have a chance to speak with Secretary Haaland, and I just said thank you. I asked her not to dwell on any of the negativity, and that she's in a tough place, you know, that she has a very important but a very challenging job, and that she will have to deal with these types of situations. But I assured her, I reassured her that everyone who was there, and even those who could not be with us on Sunday, are praying for her and are wishing her well. And we're all very hopeful that as this work continues, that our work and our contributions towards this effort will lessen the load for her.
And I do want to ask you about that. As a tribal leader, Tribes often unite on many issues, and there always are differing views, and from not only tribes, but individual tribal citizens. And the Navajo Nation has made an official statement as a tribal government expressing disappointment in the buffer for various reasons. What are your thoughts?
Well, I'm grateful that I had the opportunity to work with President Jonathan Nez, along with other Pueblo governors, to create and introduce the first version of the Chaco Protection Bill, which is really a piece of legislation that ensures this longer term protection of Chaco. That legislation has just recently been reintroduced by Senators Heinrich and Representative Congresswoman Teresa Ledger Fernandez. Anytime leaders come together in this way, I have seen that it is very powerful. And it's a true act of our solidarity and sovereignty and our commitment to uphold our inherent responsibilities as Native people to protect our resources, to protect our lands and our cultural resources, our sacred places. Because in the end, these sacred spaces will help to sustain our livelihood and our future, not only Native people, but all people. So I hope that moving forward, that our leaders, including the current president of the Navajo Nation and others, will come together and work together, that they will continue to communicate and negotiate in true government-to-government relations and in with a level of love and compassion for our people and the cultures that have sustained us for millennia.